Okay, yes. So we talk about life on FIFO again. We talked about inventory and how we can calculate ending inventory as well as cost of goods sold, right? We also talked about basically the effects of these changes on the balance sheet, the difference between the three methods, how they affect the income statement, balance sheet, as well as for tax effect. We also learned that there are sometimes errors, inventory errors, and those inventory errors would affect two periods usually, right? That usually, for example, the net income for both years would be the same as the correct balance. And that is mainly because the effect on year one will be offset by year two. Okay? Any questions about that? Well, we will finish up. We still have a couple of slides in this chapter, and then we will start with the next one. So this chapter, this part now is about the presentation on the balance sheet, etc., of inventory. Inventory is an asset account. As a result, where do we put inventory? Under? On the balance sheet, under which section? Which section under assets? So it's assets, but which section specifically? After the receivables, right? So basically in the current asset section. Okay? On the other hand, we have also on the income statement, with this cost of goods sold, right, basically after net sales, okay? And we also talked that the company must disclose what kind of inventory they have, what method they use, and whether they use cost or lower of cost or market, okay? We also learned this last time. You remember this one, LCM? No? You do, you should. It's lower of cost, whichever is lower. So in this case, for example, for gas, which one will it be? Cost or market? Market. Wood. Pellets. Market. And the total would be the sum of those three amounts. And like we mentioned, LCM can also be applied for the total, instead of just line item or category, you can also have for the total inventory. Okay? Here, for example, you have ending inventory was overstated by, in 2013, it was overstated by 22,000. So, 2013, ending inventory was overstated by 22,000. What's the impact or effect of this error on the ending inventory, cost of goods sold, as well as stockholders' equity in both 2013 and 2014. So in 2013, ending inventory will be overstated. 2014, ending inventory will be, it has no effect. You said it correctly, differently but correctly. So basically, it has no effect because the ending inventory in 2014 depends on what? The actual physical count at the end of 2014. Okay? So unless you make another mistake, which would most likely lead to firing you, but unless you make a second mistake in 2014, you assume that ending inventory will be correct. In this case, at least it has no effect on 2014. What about cost of goods sold in 2013? Understated, so 2014 it will be overstated. The effect will be offsetting each other. What about stockholders' equity? Overstated, and no effect on the second one. Why is that? Again, because in this case, the effect will be in a way offset, and plus you remember that the ending inventory will have no effect on ending inventory of 2014. So those two things, okay? Because it will be offsetting each other. If you go back to that slide, so that slide here, where is it? Here. You remember this one? This one, the incorrect one, was understated. However, you have here, this one was also understated. Okay? So the difference between the two will be the same. You guys understand that? Okay. I still want to ask that question. Understating ending inventory. You only have 30 seconds to answer it. Okay, 45 seconds. Understanding ending inventory, understating ending inventory will overstate assets, cost of goods sold, net income, owner's equity. I mean, what else can I do? I basically showed you the answer. You should. But I'll give you, basically, I'll cut you some slides because it's the beginning of the lecture. Next time, we'll have an angry face, not just a frowny face. Like the red ones with flaming. Yes, that will be me in that case. Now, it's good to have inventory, etc., but companies also need to, or investors and creditors, basically users of accounting information, they need to be able to understand what these numbers mean. Okay, so it's good to know that you have such and such ending inventory and that you have cost of goods sold of this amount. What does it really mean? How can you use this information in a useful way? So companies, they analyze inventory information, okay? And they see basically what it means. Like if you remember those, we talked about this example here. What do we mean when we have, for example, low inventory levels? What happens if you have low inventory level? You might be losing money through opportunity loss, okay? So basically you do not have, you might not have enough items or units to sell, right? On the other hand, if you have high inventory levels, that means that you are stocking up on your inventory without selling enough. So maybe you need to also improve your sales in one way or another. Maybe the price is too high, etc. Because that will also be, if you have high levels of inventory, it's not always good. If it is in technology becomes obsolete very fast, right? So your inventory might lose value very fast. And not only that, plus storing it, you need to pay for storage to keep it, etc. So this is why it's important to analyze inventory information to make the right decisions. Okay? Usually there are two main measures of that are used for analysis of inventory. You have inventory turnover and days in inventory. What do we mean by that in plain English? Inventory turnover, it means basically how many times over the year you sold your inventory. Over this year, you sold your inventory like, for example, 7 times. Which one would be better if you sold your inventory 7 times or 9 times? 9 times. So the higher the inventory turnover, usually the more sales you have. This is why to calculate inventory turnover, you divide cost of goods sold by ending inventory, right? Right? Wrong. Why? You divide by what? Average. Okay, so I was just checking if you guys are actually looking at the slides or not. You divide it by average inventory. How do you calculate average inventory? Usually, it's the beginning inventory plus ending inventory over 2. Okay, you need to take both inventory into account. Usually, unless there were like a large seasonal effects on your sales, it should be a good approximation of basically the average inventory should be a good term to use for this kind of ratio. Okay, so you divide the cost of goods sold by average inventory. How do you calculate average inventory? Beginning inventory plus ending inventory over 2. Okay? Now, sometimes you can also take that number, inventory turnover. Okay? You need to sometimes to see how long it takes you to sell your inventory. Let's say that you start today with a warehouse full of products. How long will it take you to sell that inventory? The way you do to do that is you divide the days in a year, which are 365, by, you divide them by the inventory turnover. Let's see an example here. So Walmart reported in its 2011 annual report, a beginning inventory, so the beginning inventory was 32,713,000,000. Okay? Ending inventory was 36.318 billion. And the cost of goods sold were 315 billion. I'm just giving roughly the numbers. How do you calculate the turnover? Inventory turnover is equal to the cost of goods sold divided by the average. So the cost of goods sold, you have it, and you divide that by the average. It gives you 9.1 times. What does it mean? It means that over the year 2011, Walmart sold their total inventory 9.1 times. Okay? If you look at it from a days in inventory perspective, you see that you divide 365 by 9.1, it tells you it's 40.1 days. So what does 40.1 days? It takes Walmart 40.1 days to sell their inventory completely. Any questions? So these two you have to learn. This you have to learn those for the exam. You might be asked, for example, to calculate days in inventory. You might have to first calculate the cost of goods sold, and from that one you would get inventory turnover. Okay? You might not be given directly inventory turnover. You might not be given cost of goods sold here. You might have to calculate it. And then you divide it by the average. Any questions? Yes.
Is there like a good number for
inventory turnover? It depends a lot on the industry, on the size of the company, what kind of products they have. So for example, if you're talking about Boeing, it's definitely not going to be that much. They don't sell that many. If it is smaller items like Target, Walmart, etc., you might have faster. The rule of thumb is that the higher the number, the better it is.
What about like when you have larger average inventories and it's just because of what
it means you have a lot of inventory but not as much sales. That is what it means. So if you have two, it means that during the whole year you only sold twice. Then why keep this large amount of inventory? Because like we said, large levels of inventory, they cost money. The products, the cost of products, you have insurance, because when you have more products, you have more warehouses, you have more insurance, you have more storage costs, etc., more employees. So it's all going to go up. Then why have this large level of inventory when you're not selling as much? Okay? But it's all judgment-based, so it all depends on what the company decides, what the company's management decides. On this question, they give us gross profit rate, 45%. Okay, during the year, the company had net sales of 400,000 and goods available for sale of 260. The beginning inventory was 35,000. We need to calculate the dollar amount of ending inventory. I need more time. Okay. Yes, we have 66%, correct. But despite the fact that this is a low percentage, I am going to give you a smiley face. Okay? Just to encourage you guys. Because this was not a very easy question. So how did you solve this? You are given the gross profit rate. We know the net sales. Goods available for sale were 260. We know the beginning inventory. So what do we need to calculate? Ending inventory. How do you solve? Start with whatever you have. Jason. So now, to do it systematically, you start with a gross profit rate. So what's the gross profit rate? It's equal to what? Not the numbers, formula. It's equal to? It's gross profit divided by net sales, which is 2 million. Gross profit is equal to gross profit rate multiplied by net sales. What was gross profit rate? 45% multiplied by net sales, 400,000. That would be gross profit. Now, gross profit is equal to what? Sorry? Okay, not the number. It's net sales minus cost of goods sold. So the cost of goods sold, will be equal to net sales minus gross profit, right? Net sales was 400 minus 200 minus what? How much? 180, you said, right? That would be 220. Okay, I'm forgetting the zeros, so it's fine. So it's 220. Now, we know that ending inventory is equal to cost of goods available minus cost of goods sold, which is need to mean. It's 260 minus 220. Did we use inventory at the beginning inventory? We did not need to use it. So be careful about the information that is given to you. Okay? This is based on this table here. Any questions? If you're more comfortable with it, you could have also done that, like Jason mentioned earlier, instead of having 0.4, basically 0.45, which is 45%, you do 100 minus 45%, that would be 0.55, you multiply that directly by net sales, that would give you what? So basically, you get 220. So that would be what? The cost of goods? So the cost of goods available for sale was given to us. Let's not confuse things. See how we calculated this way, step by step? I recommend that you do it this way, simply because it will not confuse you. You do that, you start with the information that you already have. You have the gross profit rate, you can and net sales, so you can get gross profit. Why? Because gross profit is equal to net sales minus cost of goods sold. We need the cost of goods sold to be subtracted from the cost of goods available for sale to get to ending inventory. Okay? Any questions? Okay. Now in this chapter, we will talk about cash and controls, okay? The reason why a lot of companies and a lot of people are interested in cash is what? Cash is money. It's easy money also to steal. It's easier to steal money than it is to steal, for example, a TV, right? TV is big. $100 you can just slip it in your pocket. Don't do either. Neither are good for you. You will go to jail basically if you do that. If you cost. Well, I'm not saying that you should do that and not get caught. I'm saying you should not do that. Just to be clear about that. So companies are very interested or very concerned about fraud mostly related to cash. Because cash is the easiest. One of the easiest types of assets that can be stolen or embezzled or hidden, anything like that. Okay? So, fraud usually is a very interesting topic, right? For fraud to occur, this is what we call the fraud triangle. There are three factors that are necessary for any fraud to occur. First of all, there must be an opportunity. So let's say that there's an employee, and that employee would like to steal money from the company. Okay, from the company's safe. The opportunity should be available. And that, for example, maybe the safe is left open the whole day. So there must be, the opportunity must exist. Generally speaking, why would employees or people in general commit fraud? In general, it is for financial reasons. For example, they have a lot of debts, they need money, so they steal that money from the company. Or sometimes they think of it as they borrow money. Sometimes indefinitely, but they're still borrowing money. So they borrow this money, or they steal this money from the company to pay their debt. In certain cases, employees, they want to live a better life than what they can actually afford. They cannot afford to buy a $10 million house, but they still want to do that, so they steal money. Okay? There's also the third part, which is rationalization. So they start thinking. The company CEO is making millions of dollars. Tons of money they make, all these executives. Whereas I'm the one who's doing the work, and I only get a very low salary. So why not also take a cut from the company's profits? This is how they start rationalizing it. Or sometimes they think about it as that I'm not stealing the money, I'm just borrowing it to invest, I'm investing it in a certain company, and then I'm going to bring the money back. Okay, what happens when you lose that money? You borrow some more money to cover the first money that you stole. This is what happens in real life. So this is why employees start rationalizing that. And in many cases, it's a slippery slope. The first time, they take a pen. The second time, they take a box of pens. Third time, they will take the laptop itself. And then after that, they start seeing it more and more. So this is what happens usually. They start rationalizing it. Okay? And this is why companies are very interested in running fraud detection software, and they hire security people to do that, etc. Now, because of this kind of fraud, did it die? Okay. Okay, we have another one. First time. Come on. Okay, don't tell anyone, but it seems that I broke the mic. Remember what no use we said from the beginning. Whatever happens in class remains in class. Okay, I fixed it. Now, sorry? I don't in depth tell my wife. Anything that happened in class. Remember what will happen, the story that will happen. She will probably divorce me, and then I will become very basically cranky and grumpy old professor. You don't want a grumpy old professor because I will take it out on you guys. If she does divorce me because of you. So this is what will happen. Then you will become cranky and it's like a vicious circle. So let's not do that. Let's keep it in class. Now, fraud happens also a lot, not just by low-level employees. It also happens by companies, by companies' management. Okay? The manager also wants to make more money. Remember when we talked, for example, about earnings management? That's different type, but it's not fraud specifically, but some management sometimes they might commit fraud also. If you remember, we talked about Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002, and we said that because there are certain companies who had committed fraud, financial fraud, actually the US Congress stepped in and they passed Sarbanes-Oxley Act in 2002 to introduce additional controls so that companies, they have to have more controls to avoid or to try and prevent fraud from happening as much as possible. In fact, companies management now, they are personally liable. So the CEO and the CFO, they sign on the ethics, basically they sign on the financial reports. So they are personally liable. And not only that, Sarbanes-Oxley also introduced additional internal controls. Internal controls are like activities and stuff like that that would, they require now companies to maintain an efficient internal control system. Those are systems, basically internal control systems that would ensure that they basically address risks associated with different business operations. Okay? Not only did SOX require companies to maintain that, an efficient internal control system, but they also require companies to report on the adequacy and efficiency of their financial systems, internal control systems, okay? In addition to that, they require external auditors to evaluate and assess the adequacy and efficiency of the company's internal control systems, and also on the management assessment. Basically, they want to see if the company is lying about the efficiency of their internal control systems. Okay? And in fact, the US government, they also basically created the PCAOB to oversee the auditing profession. Until SOX, the auditing profession was self-governing profession. Okay? Now, what are internal controls? Why does a company need them? So internal controls, they safeguard assets. Okay, give me an example. How many of you already heard of the term internal control before today? Okay, so when you think of internal control, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Yes. That's not specifically a control. But you actually use internal controls to make sure that you see everything where it goes. So, yes?
You know, like private security systems with included access for certain people only.
Exactly, okay. So that's correct. If you have like a security system with limited access, yes?
Anti-money laundering
activities?
Anti-money laundering procedures and user activity laws.
Okay, so anti-money laundering procedures, right? So this is basically different activities. Those might be more than one control to make sure that no money laundering occurs, right? So for example, if you want to make a deposit of larger that is larger than 10,000, that's usually the case. If you want to make that, you have to explain why you're making such a large deposit. Where does the money come from? Yes?
A POS system at a retail establishment.
POS system specifically is a reporting system, but what do you, there is something that is associated with that. Like the username and password that the employees or the swipe or when they swipe their cards. What happens? Whenever they swipe their card, any transaction that occurs is related to that user, right? So this is a control. Who can access your files other than you? No one. But there are always super users, etc., but this is a totally different thing. But generally speaking, your colleague cannot access it unless you gave them your password. That's your fault, that's your responsibility. I have my card. If I want to make a copy at school, I have to swipe my card. In this case, this is a control to see how many copies I am making. If I am making a large number of copies unnecessarily, then there's something fishy about that. Okay? So all these are different types of controls. Locked drawers. If you have money and you lock them in a drawer, this is one kind of control. Physical access. Limiting physical access to an asset. Okay? And usually, internal controls will improve the efficiency of operations by limiting, for example, by limiting redundancies in certain cases, or by making sure that no one is stealing and that everyone is doing their job, etc. So you have different kinds of controls. Okay? You also have controls to make sure that the company is following the regulations, so they are not, for example, violating certain law. Those are the five components of internal control systems. The first one is the control environment. This is sometimes called the tone at the top. This is what the company explains to their employees, what the company explains to their employees, what they mean by what's their policies, etc. Okay? Risk assessment is a very important step. Risk assessment, it actually evaluates different business processes and the risks associated with different business operations and business processes. Okay? So you have risk assessment. Control risk assessment is a very important step in deciding what to audit. And based on this assessment, the company would implement certain policies and procedures. This is where the procedures come into place, what we call control activities. Those are the ones that actually try to mitigate that risk. They try to address the risks that were evaluated. Okay, so you have a certain risk of stealing. They said that you have a certain risk of someone taking money from the drawer. So what do? You buy a safe and you lock the money inside, right? If you have easy access to inventory, what do? You lock it and then you assign basically, let's say, swipe cards. You want to take something out from the inventory, you swipe your card. If something goes missing, that's easy. Look at the logs. Who accessed that inventory? So those are different control activities that can mitigate the risks, the various risks. Okay? Now, internal control systems, and you will read in the book that they talk about monitoring them periodically to see, for example, that this auditors and management, etc., they usually monitor internal controls regularly to make sure that they are functioning and working in space. And they are working, and they are basically not switched off, etc. Well, personally, and at Rutgers in general, in the car lab, in our research center, we believe that this does not make any sense to do that regularly. Why is that? Imagine that, for example, you look at this swipe card. We said that anyone who wants to enter the inventory needs to swipe their card, right? Is it foolproof? What can you do to avoid doing that? Or how can you do something to screw up that system? Let me put it this way. They borrow someone else's car if they allow you to do that. They are liable for that. But there's also an even worse way. Yes? If you lose a car and no one reports it, and it's fine if you lose it, and then someone finds it and they start stealing stuff because they will issue you a new car. What?
Someone can leave the door stopped in the door and everyone just walks in.
Exactly. And many people actually do that instead of bothering about like keeping swiping. Okay, so it's taking too much time. They just open it one time, and then everyone keeps going back and forth, and they stop it with the indoor stop. There is an actual control there. Is it being in use? Now, the problem with periodical monitoring of this thing is that, okay, so we see that the auditor arrived, we take the door stop. How can the auditor know that the people were not using the system? As far as I'm concerned, they look at it, yes, it's working. Right? What about the period? Usually it happens every 6 months, those periodical visits. They happen every 6 months, sometimes even longer. What happened during these 6 months? They said that you were an employee and you have been stealing from the company for 6 months. Before the next audit, the next visit by management or by auditors, etc. You have enough time to steal a lot. You might have even left the company. Well, good luck catching you. This money is out. So we believe that we should implement something that is called continuous control monitoring. We talked before about continuous auditing. Do you remember that? This is when something is done on a more frequent way. And actually, there are companies who run continuous control monitoring every night. Like Siemens, for example, they run that every night. They check their controls every night. And even if it's not all of them, but at least part of them. If there is any issue with any control, it is reported immediately to management, to the person who is supposed, basically the business owner, to the auditor. And this case will remain open and it will be repeated every day until it's fixed. After, let's say, if it is not fixed within a certain period of time, the auditor will step in and say, okay, so why are you not fixing that control? Okay? And Rutgers, like I mentioned, is one of the best research centers. We have one of the best research centers in the country, if not in the world, that deal with these things. Okay? Now, this information is important, but like I mentioned, so if the system is just capturing that information, what's the next step? You need to also communicate that information. So it's not important only just to capture that there was some kind of control violation. And you'll see in a second, control violations are basically happen very often, although people will tell you that no, but it's almost impossible to have a company with zero control violations. I'll give you an example of control violation. But before that, like, this is why it's important to communicate that information, so that people in charge would act upon that information. Like I mentioned, with Siemens, for example, they transfer that information to the auditor as well as the business owner, who will try to fix that problem. If it doesn't get fixed, the auditor would have to step in. Now, for example, I'll give you a small example. Usually, any employee, to make a payment, there is a credit limit or like a payment limit, right? Employees, for example, are not supposed to make a payment or to authorize a payment above $5,000. And that's not an actual threshold. This is depends on each company. But let's say that your limit is $5,000. Anything beyond $5,000, you cannot authorize that payment. You cannot sign the check without the approval of the management, of your manager. Okay? Now, what if you are the person who actually, you are the manager and you are the one who is writing the check and approving the check? What can happen? You might pay yourself. You might pay your friend. Who knows? Why? Because no one is actually controlling you. No one is monitoring your activities. Usually, one person is supposed to prepare the check, the other person is supposed to approve it. This is what we call segregation of duties. Now, you can say also that why don't companies, they just implement some very strict controls? Let's say that, for example, you are a customer at a certain bank. You have $20,000 in your account. You write a check for $25,000. What happens to that check? Generally speaking, it bounces. Are there any situations where the company, where the bank, might let that go? They might allow you to do that even though you don't have enough in your balance. Do you want the bank to have this possibility? Or do you want it to be basically a very rigid rule? You do realize in real life, bank managers, so a branch manager, they have the right to override that control. What do we mean by override that control? Although the check was above the balance, they might allow it to go through. They might pay it. Why is that? When do you think this could happen? Let's say that you are a business owner. Okay? You have in your personal account $20,000. But you also have with the bank a business account where you have $500,000. By mistake, you use the wrong checkbook. You paid with the wrong checkbook. The bank manager knows that you have another bank account. The bank account, the other bank account has in it a balance of $500,000. Do you think that they are going to reject your check? Or are they going to notify you so that you will transfer the money to your other account because you made this mistake? In many cases, the bank would actually override the control and would allow that payment to go through. So it's not always that you want it to be very rigid. This is why branch managers, they have certain authority to basically override certain controls. Okay? This is why when sometimes there is something wrong, there is a person who's supposed to be able to fix it. I don't know if I told you about that. We were working with a huge data set one time and we found a payment for $660 million. And we were like, okay, so what's with this payment? And then there was the reversal of that payment. So someone actually canceled that payment. You should not, as a user, you cannot initiate a payment and cancel it as well. You cannot cancel a payment. You cannot manipulate the transactions. There are certain super users who have the authority to make such cancellations and to make high amount transactions. It turned out that this employee had probably made a mistake, maybe added a couple of zeros, etc. It was canceled, so it was captured. Okay? It was captured, it was canceled, however it happened. So there is always someone who should have a level of level of authority to override certain controls. You cannot have it very rigid. You must have it for business to run smoothly. You should have some kind of flexibility. It's this kind of flexibility that sometimes causes problems. To go back to the example with the bank manager, you want the bank manager to be able to accommodate certain clients when they make a check that is higher than the limit, et cetera, right? However, you do not want that manager to do that excessively. So you still need to have some kind of detective control where you can say that, okay, so this is too much. We were working on one project with a bank, actually, where they would sell insurance policy. And when they sell insurance policy, basically they sell that product, they open an account to the client. The client, basically, they can cancel the account within a certain period of time. As employee, once you open that account, you get what? A commission. So we found that there were a lot of cases where someone would open the account and then they canceled it within 1 week. The employees got their commission. Actually, two branch managers got fired because of that. We had in the project, we identified those people who did that excessively. Turned out that there was some kind of collusion. They would strike deals with their customers. Okay, so we'll give you a loan on one condition. You open this account and then you close it within 2 weeks. They close it within 2 weeks or a week or two. They get to keep the commission, and the only party that is losing the money is the bank. We identified that by running developing a continuous control monitoring system for them. They used to run it every day, and they would capture those people. Within a very short period of time, it dropped from hundreds and thousands of people who did that to two people. To two transactions that were actually legitimate. So basically, this works as a much more efficient way than basically periodic control. And I know that I digress, and you will not find that in the book, but this is something that you need to understand. A lot of companies, audit firms, accounting firms, they are actually moving to look at, and even what several big companies, they are at their internal audit departments, they are introducing things that are more efficient than just periodic audit. Okay, we talked about this. Now, there are different types of controls. You have, as the name suggests, preventive controls. Those are controls that would prevent a certain transaction from even occurring at the beginning, like we said, for example, entering the same invoice twice for payment. If you enter the same invoice number twice, there might be, like, the company can have a preventive control that would reject that transaction. Okay? You have detective controls. Those happen after the fact, after the transaction has happened. So this is like an example of this, is the continuous control monitoring system that I just told you about with that bank that we developed for that bank. What happens is that this happens after the fact. So the transactions would go through, and at the end, we run the analysis and we identify any suspicious transactions. Third one is corrective controls. This is where the company might actually have controls. And the controls are not just related to transactions. Controls could also be like, for example, preventing your data from being lost, backing up your data, having like uninterrupted power supplies, etc. Okay? The principles of internal controls, usually they vary with the management's policy. Basically, this is what the management and how strict the management wants to be. So for example, a company that deals with money directly usually are stricter than a company that deals with cars. It's much more difficult to steal cars than it is to steal money, right? So you have different companies, plus the size of the company and the nature of the industry of that company. That makes controls very different. And controls are not only just to identify fraud. You remember when I told you about that company in the stock market who lost like around $500 million in a few minutes? They simply had the wrong code that kept doing those transactions and they kept losing money. Well, if they did not have a control that would immediately capture this weird pattern of transactions, they could not have stopped it in time. How many of you have ever used some kind of internal controls, some controls? That's correct. So for example, you're using your credit card, you try to buy something very high or unusual. So you see what they do? They do what we call pattern recognition. This is called pattern recognition. So usually you spend $200 a week. All of a sudden they found that you are spending $4,000. That's suspicious. They will stop the transaction, they will call you and tell you, are you actually the one who's purchasing this item? Yes or no? And it's very complicated sometimes what's okay in a certain time, it could be weird in another time. So for example, if you usually spend $200 per month, per week, okay? However, in a certain week you spend $1,000. Is it weird or no? What if that week was Christmas? It's not as weird, because you might be basically actually buying those gifts, Christmas gifts, etc., etc. So your spending during the holidays are higher. That's understandable. So there are those seasonal effects. And so there are different things, and usually you try to identify not just fraud, but even mistakes. Okay, so there's anything wrong with your system. I was running a duplicate detection algorithm, and I found that there were certain transactions that had a commission. The type of transaction included a commission fee. And the company told me that they stopped using commission fee like 3 years ago. But they simply forgot to remove that from the drop-down list. So that was not someone trying to defraud the company. There was no one who was trying to steal from the company, but they were inefficient in cleaning up their system. Another example is in many cases, like username and password. Those are usually whenever you leave your job or as soon as you graduate, they will disable your access to certain resources that are only for Rutgers students, or in my case, for example, Rutgers faculty. If I leave Rutgers, I should not have the permission to access those resources, right? However, what if the computing services were not efficient and they failed to delete or disable my username? I could still access the company. I could still take advantage of their resources, which is wrong. Okay? So there are six principles, usually, that are associated with internal control activities. We will be focusing on internal control activities. You remember we had five components, right? This is the ones here, the pyramid. Those are the five, okay? We will be focusing on this one here. Because this is actually, those are the procedures that the companies actually implement to do that. So for example, you have what we call establishment of responsibility. This is basically to make sure that the person who actually, let's say that it's a cash register. In order for me to steal money from that register, or if the money in the register does not add up to what we sold today, I should be the only person who's using that register. Because in this case, you can say, okay, the money is missing. You are the only one who had access to the register. Where's the money? Right? In the same way, for example, you could have that for checks. If I'm the only person who is authorized to sign checks, there was a check that was signed, someone will tell me, okay, so you were the only person who had access to those checks. Where is this extra check? Why did you pay it? Okay? The usernames and passwords, etc., those are one type of establishing your responsibility. The example about using the swipe card to access the inventory, this is actually, it indicates that only one person, this person who swiped the card, had access at that time to inventory. If it were like three people, it would be almost impossible to say that, okay, so this is the person who stole it, without access to a different kind of controls. The different kind of controls, like for example, physical controls. If you have security cameras that would capture at the same time who swiped in and who actually physically went in. Segregation of duties. When I travel as an employee, when I come back, I file a reimbursement request. Basically, I file for reimbursement for my travel expenses, okay? So I travel, I request a reimbursement for my travel expenses. I should should not be also the same person who approves my travel expenses. Otherwise, I could put like, for example, okay, so I spent $10,000 for a trip to Philadelphia. And I'm approving it. No one is actually verifying the information that I'm putting in that request. If I approve it, it will be signed. So the person who actually initiates a certain transaction should not be the same person who actually approves that transaction. This is what we call segregation of duty. And then we have documentation procedures. If I have to submit the request to for reimbursement for my travel expenses, I should also submit documentation, like receipts. For example, my invoice, my credit card statement to show that I actually paid for the plane ticket, etc., etc. Then you have also independent verification, like, for example, internal auditors who would actually verify the information after I submit them and after the approving person approves of them, etc. And then you have also human resources controls. Human resources controls are, for if you apply, later on when you apply for jobs, in many cases they will even run like a drug test, they will ask you to, they will run a background check on you to see if you did not steal any money, for example, from a previous company. This is why they ask you for references. They will call your previous employer and will ask them, why did they leave the company? If the previous employer tells them, for example, well, he was not very honest, then you shouldn't be hiring that person. Okay? Or while he was working on inventory, a lot of items went missing. After we fired him, the missing inventory stopped. So basically, this is the job of human resources where they ask you to run all these kinds of tests and controls. Okay. So here we talk about, well, we talked about this actually. So establishment of responsibility to make sure that, for example, only one person at a time has access to that asset. In this case, you can say that, okay, it's your responsibility, you're in charge of it. If it goes missing, that's your fault. Let me give you an example. This is microphone. Let's say that this microphone gets stolen. Can the university blame it on me? Can they blame it on me? They can't. Because I'm not the only person who uses it. Anyone who is here can steal it. Right? If someone steals my laptop, that's a different story, because I'm the only person who's supposed to have it. So if something wrong happens to it, I have to report it, that someone stole it. They say that someone stole my map. But if at a certain point they ask me, where is it, and I tell them, oh, I don't have it. Why don't you have it? Then it's my fault. Okay? If they gave me the microphone and they told me, you're saying you have to keep it with you at all times, and it goes missing, then I have to say that, okay, then I will be responsible for it. This is what we mean by establishment of responsibility. Person who is in charge, for example, for a cash register, at the end of the day, they should be the only ones who are in charge of that cash register. Actually, certain companies, they use multiple drawer registers. So if they have more than one employee, they can use different drawers. So drawer one would be for me, drawer one would be for my colleague. In this case, if money is missing from drawer two, it's not my fault, it's my colleague's. Go get it. It's not my fault. Segregation of duties, this is what I said, that usually it's a good practice to segregate or separate the different duties of the same related transactions. So for example, the persons who enter or who account for cash are different from the persons who, or should be different from the persons who actually handle the cash. Because at the end, a third person should be able to look at those two numbers and say that, okay, so the cash that I received from Hussein is the same amount that the point of sale, that the accounting system showed me that this is the sales we have, or the cash register, okay? This is what it means. In this case, this is what segregation of duty would allow me to do. Segregation of duty would also mean If I am the person to initiate a certain a purchase order, I should not be also the one who approves of it. Otherwise, I can just keep buying stuff for my house. Then you have documentation, but invoices, when we sell, when we send invoices, or basically if you receive, when you send invoices to your customers, you have, basically they should be pre-numbered, they should be all accounted for. Same thing when it comes to, for example, checks. They should be pre-numbered, all accounted for, because otherwise, what if you have a missing invoice? That invoice could have been paid to your friend. Okay? A fictitious vendor. And this happens a lot, more than you can imagine. Sometimes you have those fictitious vendors, and someone is paying a practically non-existing person. The checks are going somewhere, and because there is an invoice missing, no one is actually looking at it. Okay? Physical controls are like safes, doors, security cameras, you have alarm systems. Inventory should not be like just open for everyone, should have access control, all these things. Independent verification, we talked about that. Independent internal verification. Because here we're not talking about external auditors, we're talking about still within the same company. Internal verification. Most of the time, big companies, they have internal audit departments who would handle this kind of job. They would verify all the information. Like for example, when I apply for reimbursement, it has to go through a proper channel. It reaches the auditors. The auditors would have to verify that the documentation that I'm presenting is actually not falsified or it's correct. And then they would say that, okay, so this is correct. They would then send it back for payments, etc. They do not handle the payments, but they would basically approve the payment, stuff like that, okay? Human resources controls, we talked about that. A lot of companies actually, they use what we call like the bond employees. They, basically, employees at this point, they would know that the insurance company will go after them very, very aggressively if they conduct, basically, if they have any misconduct or if they commit fraud. Another way is what we call mandatory vacations. A lot of companies, they require their employees to take a vacation. So even if you say that, no, I want to continue work, they would require that you take a vacation. And why is that? This is not because they love you. That's not the case. Why is that? Sorry? Paid vacations, even paid vacation, but they will require you to rotate or to change to work in a different department or to take a vacation. They require you to take a vacation. Yes. Exactly. So if something is going missing, usually you can hide it up, right? So if you steal something from the drawer or the safe, no one would know that you did that until someone else takes over that work and then would say, okay, where's the money? Why is it missing? And a lot of fraud actually was captured because of this mandatory vacation or mandatory rotation. Because in this case, the company, the employee, will be out of his position for a certain period of time, which would enable another person, unless they were both in it together. In which case, that's a totally different thing. It's called collusion. Unless there was collusion, it's very difficult for this to happen. If I, for example, take over my colleague's work, and I see that, okay, so there are certain checks that are missing. Where are they? Or there's money that's missing. Or I'm supposed to have 100, basically 10 TVs in the storehouse, and in my warehouse, and I only have 8. Where did those 2 go? I'm not going to take the blame for it, so I will report that information. Okay? So this is what we mean, basically what can be done through those mandatory rotations. 10 minutes only? Only 10 minutes? Wow. So limitations of internal controls. Again, internal controls are not foolproof. Okay? There are always ways of switching off those internal controls, overriding the controls. However, even without that, controls sometimes they reach a certain point where it becomes very expensive to have 100% assurance. This is why companies they look for reasonable assurance. So for example, can a company stop shoplifting 100%? Yes, they can. By frisking every customer who's getting out of the door, they will stop each customer and they will give them a thorough physical inspection, etc., to see that they did not steal anything. However, what would that do to their business operations? They will lose customers. A lot of customers would refuse to go there anymore. They would say, okay, I'm not going there. I'd rather pay a little bit more at the other company. So this is one way that is possible, but it would cost a lot more than they benefit from it. So this is why it would be enough to have a sign that says we reserve the right to basically look at your bags, etc. And that basically shoplifters will be prosecuted. All these things, right? And they have all these security cameras to monitor and have some employees to monitor if someone's trying to shoplift. That's cheaper to the company from having someone stop each employee, each customer, and looking at their bags, etc. Okay? So this is just an example of the limitations of controls. Again, controls can be switched off, can be companies can or employees can override certain controls. For example, segregation of duty, while it's important, but sometimes companies, especially smaller companies, they might not have enough employees to have a person who would initiate the transaction and another one who would approve of it. Now, we will talk about cash controls because this is one of the most important parts here that companies care about. Cash controls are in the same way. And by the way, when you talk about cash, those cash receipts can come from sales. It can come from selling a certain truck, from collecting, for example, notes, okay? From investment, etc. And the cash receipts controls are the same one. You have to establish responsibility. You have to document the procedures. When you receive cash, you have to make sure that you are receiving cash for a certain sale. You have to also have segregation of duties. The same human resources controls. You also have to have physical controls, keep the money in a safe or in a locked room. Independent internal verification as well. Now, what companies, they usually have over-the-counter, so basically they have different types of receipts. They either have over-the-counter receipts, so when the company runs it, make a sale. In this case, the employee starts all with the employee, types in the total amount or the number, basically they scan or types in the sale, they run the sale. And in this case, at the end of the day, they count the cash and they send it over the cashier. Okay? The cashier will count the cash, prepare a deposit slip, and then send a copy, the original copy with the cash, to the bank. They deposit the money at the bank, and they send a copy of the deposit slip to accounting department. In parallel, you have the supervisor who will take the cash register, the tape from the cash register in more sophisticated accounting systems where you have the point of sale. You would have the information directly sent to the accounting department. However, this information is sent directly to the accounting department. The accounting department will compare the amount that was deposited to the amount on the sales revenue. The two amounts should be the same. If they are not the same, then the company will have to basically, the person, if the cash is less, the employee will have to answer for it. Okay? Now the other type is when the company receives checks and they have to deposit those checks. Usually these checks are opened by two clerks, two employees, not one, two. So unless the two were colluding, unless the two were together, it will be unlikely that someone would steal the check. Because there are two people, it's opened in front of each other. They mark it for deposit only, for deposit only. And why is that? When you have it for deposit only, what's happened? For deposit only, it will lead to having, basically the bank will not give cash to anyone, it will only be deposited in a certain bank account. And the advantage is that if for any reason the company later on claims that this is not the person I sent the money to, automatically, the bank can trace it to the account owner. Okay? Now, the two clerks will prepare a list for all the checks with the names of the check issuer. Basically, this is the payer, the purpose, why is it paid, and the amount. They sign that list. They prepare three copies of that list. They sign them. They send the original along with the checks. They send it to the cashier's department, who will later on deposit it at the bank. They send another copy to the accounting department. They record those payments. Remember, we still need to make the journal entries, right? They prepare those payments, those entries, and then the clerks will keep a copy for their own sake. Now, there are two different controls here. The first one is that there are two different clerks. Another control, in this case, is the customer herself, because if she does not get credited for the amount that she paid, they will complain. Customers will not say, okay, so we paid you the first time, you did not, someone stole the money, okay, I paid you the second time. No, they won't do that. They will complain about it until, and then the company will know that. So this acts as a second control. Okay? Usually we have two kinds of cash disbursements. And I'm pretty sure that you guys are not even listening to what I'm saying. So have a good weekend and see you on Monday.